Good morning. I'm Brandee McHale. I'm the president of the Citi Foundation. First, let me start by thanking our hosts at Aspen for inviting us to participate today. It is really a privilege to be with all of you. I mean, what a great way to wake up in the morning and come together with so many colleagues and thought leaders in this space, and to be part of this robust exchange of ideas and perspectives on increasing access to opportunity and financial security for more Americans. I cannot think of a better gathering to unveil the Financial Diaries, which provides new insights into the financial lives of households in America. In an era where we have 24-hour-a-day news analysis and we check our social media accounts on a constant basis, we're bombarded with information about the challenging nature of life these days. This discourse permeates and infuses our conversations, and it feels as though the American dream is a nostalgic idea. An idea that belongs to our parents' and grandparents' generation, a distant, fading memory we're trying hard to grasp onto. As philanthropists, we spend a lot of time thinking and talking about the root causes of the challenges we face today and how to ensure that the essence of the American dream, mobility, opportunity, and equality, are not a vestige of the past, but a reflection of the present, and a promise for the future. We debate the structural issues and seemingly irreversible trends that are changing how we live our lives day to day and leave us questioning our notion of the American dream. And we work to invest and test new ideas and scale the best of what works. Like many foundations, underlying our work at the Citi Foundation has been the quest for that one moonshot idea with the potential to change the trajectory for millions of individuals who are struggling financially. This is a laudable goal for sure, but I'd argue a goal infused with a faulty approach. How can we ever expect to impact the people we seek to serve if we don't ever actually stop to talk to them? Now, this simple and obvious epiphany was a key catalyst for why the Citi Foundation and our colleagues at the Ford Foundation backed the U.S. Financial Diaries project from day one. We recognize that while we have lots of data, in fact, more data and information than we've ever had at our fingertips before, about wealth inequality, the changing nature of work, wage and home ownership trends, and the impact of education, there was still something missing. I believe the critical piece of this puzzle is perspective, the personal and real-time perspective of the people whose lives we seek to impact. So the Financial Diaries followed American households to see how they actually manage their financial lives, and not on an annual or even a quarterly basis, but looking day to day and week to week over the course of a year. In fact, the term diaries may actually be misleading, because the research isn't simply a record of what happened to our households over this time period, but it's an analysis of the behaviors, the coping mechanisms, and the resiliency of the families and the communities they're a part of. We knew the project would be challenging, finding families who would be comfortable opening up about their personal lives for so long was going to be tough. And further, you know, there was some concern about the time frame. By the time we made sense of all of the diaries, would it be too late? Would the work still be relevant? As I stand here this morning with all of you, I think the findings are more critical now than when we first started. The book is a great read. I encourage all of you to, after this panel, to order a copy and dig in. The research has changed the way I look at the challenges we have to take on. It's not a bad news or sad news story. It's given me hope and new ideas for addressing the widening opportunity gap in the United States. If we know where we need to get to and why, we'll all have a better idea of how to get there. So again, I encourage you all to participate fully in today's session and have the opportunity to hear directly from the authors, but also encourage you all to pick up the book after today's event. So without further ado, Please join me in welcoming the leaders of the U.S. Financial Diaries Project and the authors of the brand new book, The Financial Diaries, How American Families Cope in a World of Uncertainty, Jonathan Morduch and Rachel Schneider. Jonathan is a professor of public policy and economics at the Wagner Graduate School of Public Service at NYU. Rachel is a senior vice president at the Center for Financial Services Innovation. And they will be joined by a special guest, David Leonhardt. David is an associate editorial page editor and op-ed columnist for the New York Times, where he was also founding editor of The Upshot. Present the Financial Diaries.
I love this research both for substantive reasons and nerdy reasons. So the substantive reasons are that I really think this is the most important, along with climate change, I think this is the most important issue we're grappling with as a society. And then although we're obviously not here to talk about climate change, it actually affects climate change because I think the level of frustration and anxiety we see in society makes it harder to address a problem like climate change. And so this notion of living standards for the majority of the population, regardless of your politics, at this point, you shouldn't need any convincing that this is just a central issue to our society for both reasons of people's lives, their health, and our politics. That's the substantive reason. So the nerdy reason is Jonathan and Rachel like to say that what they're doing is they're showing a movie rather than a snapshot. And I think that's actually a really profound insight, and it's a nice metaphor, too. We don't even realize the extent to which our knowledge of society is based on snapshots. The unemployment rate, the census report that comes out, the GDP, nearly everything we know about our society and our economy is based on snapshots. There's a reason for that. Movies are really hard in social science because you got to go find the same people year after year after year. And if you lose some of them, suddenly your findings aren't good, right? Because the people you lost probably are not like the ones you didn't lose. But there's also a real problem with snapshots, which is in this country, what we care about is opportunity, not equality of outcomes, but this notion of opportunity. And you really can't study opportunity and understand it unless you have a movie. If you're just doing snapshots, you don't know year to year whether the person who was poor one year is also poor the next. And so I think when you think about both the importance of the work and the fact that there's really a flowering of work in a number of different fields, sociology, economics, that is really trying to move toward movies, I think that's why I find this work so compelling and I'm excited to be here today with you guys. So with that far too long introduction, which is just my way of saying I'm really pleased to be on stage with you, can you guys start by telling us what you did before we get into what you found?
Sure. So you said this, and Brandee said it also, you know, part of what inspired us was that there's actually so much information in the US, and yet in spite of all of that information, we found ourselves really inspired by work that had been done internationally. So Jonathan was part of a project prior that resulted in a book called Portfolios of the Poor, where this same kind of year-long dive was done. And so really the original inspiration was that work, and we were from the get-go sort of amazed by the extent that in the US we have just reams and reams and reams of data, and yet there are these big questions, big why questions about why people are doing what they're doing that we couldn't answer, that nonetheless in this international work you could start to answer. And so Brandee, along with a group of other funders at the Ford Foundation and ultimately the Omidyar Network, really wanted to replicate that experience. And so the idea from the beginning was really about why.
So what we did is to create a special kind of movie, and you described one kind of movie, which is year after year following the same people, and we don't have enough of that kind of data. But what Rachel and I decided to do was to create a movie that was shorter term, but went much deeper. And so it was really a movie that followed households in different parts of the US. We were in California, we were in Mississippi, we were in the Cincinnati area, we were in New York. We identified 235 households that were willing to let us into their lives for a full year and allowed us to track every single dollar they earned, saved, spent, and shared, like every single financial transaction. It was sort of insane in a way. But they opened up their lives to us and allowed us to spend time and try to understand what was going on, the ups and downs, week by week, month by month. And that's really the story that we want to tell. Now, the sample wasn't a nationally representative sample. That would be too difficult. But we did try to capture typical experiences of an important part of the population that's been hard to see. So about a quarter of the population was, the sample that we looked at was below the poverty line. About a half was between the poverty line and kind of median income in their areas, and about a quarter was above that. So we caught some households were definitely struggling, some households that were clearly middle class. And we wanted to see how these different strata, different groups were doing. And the one thing that made our sample special and focused on mobility was that everybody in the sample had at least one working member. So we're not looking at the households that are struggling the most in America. We're really looking at households that have opportunities, and we wanted to see whether they were meeting them and how they were dealing with goals.
And I assume you had a mix of households with two workers and one worker, kids, not kids,
yeah,
all kinds of things.
Exactly.
Like that.
And
so tell us about the central findings and bring some of the people to life. That...
You want to start?
Well, there were really a few big things that jumped out. Once we're following the households week by week, I mean, the biggest thing was just how much instability there was in people's lives. So, for example, we got to know a family, Becky and Jeremy. And Jeremy and Becky live in Ohio, north of Cincinnati, in a small town. And Jeremy earns his income. He's the main earner in the family. He's a mechanic on long-haul trucks, those huge trucks. And it turns out, we went to visit in spring. It was a beautiful day. And it turns out that Becky was really down. I was like, what's going on? She's like, this is just terrible for us. Jeremy's next paycheck is going to be crap, she said. I'm quoting. and I'm like, why? And she said, well, spring is just terrible. In the winter, trucks, they fall apart. The alternators freeze up. In the summer, it's really great because truck tires blow and Jeremy's busy all day. But spring and fall, the weather's too good and the trucks are doing fine and Jeremy's just sitting at work not doing very much. And like a lot of Americans, he's working on commission. So the risk of the ups and downs, they're falling on his shoulders. And that kind of up and down, whether you're working on commission, you're working on tips, or if you're an hourly worker and you're not getting the hours that you're counting on week after week, that turns out to be a big deal across our sample. So on this, the one big statistic that sort of captures the situation was that across our sample, we looked at households month by month who either had a month that was 25% above average or 25% below average, these big spikes and dips. And across our sample, on average, households had 5 months with either a spike or a dip. 5 months. That meant 5 out of the 12 months of the year, they weren't even close to their average. And that meant that planning and budgeting and feeling in control was much, much, much more difficult.
Right. And so the way that plays out for Becky and Jeremy, for example, is that she was wondering whether or not to pay her mortgage, right? And it's not, she had the money in hand now and is sort of burning a hole in her pocket, like, I'd like to pay it. But she felt like if she did and then she didn't have the cash later, she'd have to go borrow from her sister. And so what we see is that people are much more consumed with these decisions of what in the book we end up talking about these decisions of soon. And most of our sort of mental model about financial decision making is that people are going to be thinking, is the opportunity framework you described, right? That people are going to be thinking about these big things that lead to mobility. Am I going to go to college? Am I going to get a better job? Am I going to save for retirement? But a lot of times what we heard from people was about how am I going to pay X, Y, or Z bill? And I'm going to juggle this. I'm going to not pay my cell phone bill this month so that I can pay my rent. And then next month I'm going to catch up on my rent and I'm going to pay my utility bill, right? And so, we asked one particularly like upwardly striving family in the sample, what's your primary financial objective? And this is somebody who was going to college en route to a better job, and she still said, I just want to be able to pay all my bills in full and on time every month. And so this sort of constant way of thinking about soon forces people to come up with different kinds of strategies for how to manage their life. We can talk more about it as we get further into the conversation. But you know, for Becky, it means that she spends, she stockpiles. She buys things whenever they're on sale and has, you know, huge amounts of toothpaste in her pantry. Because that's a way to manage this concern about what will happen in 2 months or 3 months, and what if the paycheck's low? Well, she knows she'll always be able to feed her family because her freezer is full.
I mean, one thing that strikes me is that there's some financial costs of this instability, right? Mm-hmm. You probably end up paying higher interest. But they're also really emotional and probably even translate into health costs. I mean, one of the things that we know from psychological research about all kinds of things are just the costs of uncertainty, right? We've all had this feeling, right? If you're trying to plan a trip and there are three or four things up in the air, sometimes it can be paralyzing. And these folks are living with that about nearly everything in their lives. How did you see the emotional and psychological toll play out for them?
Yeah, it's a real struggle. We met a woman in New York, Sandra Young. She's an accountant. She really was on top of her finances. In fact, she had a spreadsheet. It was amazing when she really budgeted to the day. And if she was off by one day, she'd go back to the next day and she'd revise her spreadsheet. But she was being so careful because in the past, things had become a little bit out of line and she'd taken on debt and then she'd got stuck with the debt. And that really burdened her, right? This feeling of being in debt so much that she refused to take debt anymore, refused to have credit cards, refused to borrow. And it burdened her so much that when her kids were thinking about going to college, she said, you can go to college, but we're not going to borrow for that. And so her burden translated into a lack of mobility, really, for her kids. She would have been better off feeling comfortable borrowing.
I actually think that's a really important point. I think all of the discussion and the complaining about college debt in particular and debt more generally, debt is really important, right?
Huge.
Affluent people use debt in all kinds of ways, and most Americans can't get a car, can't get a house, can't get an education without debt. And if we make it so scary and then sometimes have it such bad side effects that people run away from it, you're really talking about restricting long-term opportunities in all kinds of terrible ways.
You are. Well, you are. And debt is complicated because in some ways it's just the flip side of saving, right? Either way, what you're trying to do is accumulate a usefully large sum is the way I think they referred to that in the Portfolios of the Poor work. And right, sometimes you just need a chunk of money that's bigger than you can put together in any 1 month. And debt is a natural way to do that. And it feels very different to people to borrow than it does to save and then spend that money. And sometimes the easier choice is to borrow for good reason and pay it back. And yet, sometimes what we heard is people sort of wishing there was a way that they could borrow, but know they wouldn't overborrow. We talked with one young woman in California who had a lot of student debt. She'd done everything right from an opportunity perspective because she had gone to college. She was the first in her family to do so. And she was paying that off slowly. And at some point she said, you know, that she felt like she was only a few months away from paying down all of her credit card debt. But then she had a series of things go wrong. Like she got in a car accident, needed a new car. And she described it later and said, well, that was the moment. That was the nail in the coffin of the credit card pay down. And this is somebody who watches her credit score really, really closely. And at the end of our conversation, she said, you know, I wish I got points for paying down. And I wish, versus for spending, right? And I wish I knew that there was a limit. Like, right, she was assuming that if she could get the credit, somebody thought she could pay it back.
You guys have said that the metaphors hand to mouth and paycheck to paycheck are wrong. Why are they wrong?
Yeah, it's interesting. So we tend to think just casually, and people feel like they're living paycheck to paycheck, and that's the source of economic insecurity. But it's wrong in that it suggests that households are sort of passive in the face of what's hitting them, and that they're just totally pushed to their max, to their constraints. But in fact, we saw households really maneuvering. They were saving and they were borrowing. Just like Rachel was saying, you know, we see households, even they have a hard time, Becky and Jeremy, the household she was talking about, who were, like, stocked up their freezer, you know, they're still doing something. We saw lots of people coming up with other ways to manage their finances in these difficult situations. So, for example, a woman named Janice, she works in a casino. in Mississippi. I just saw her last week. She was really happy because last week it was really busy at the casino. She earns most of her money from tips. And she's like, it's tax season. And the casino is really busy. And I'm like, oh no. And she felt that too. She wasn't happy for her customers, but she's like, they're betting $25 a pop, $25 a bet. And when we look at her her income over time, and we have a graph here.
Oh, good.
You can see that her income's going up and down, and she's earning most of her money in the summer. When kids go back to school, football season happens, so people staying home watching TV, Janice's income falls. The weight of that is on her shoulders. And so Janice knows that she's got to deal with that. And so one of the things that she does to save, rather than just accepting it, is she opened a bank account an hour away. It's a credit union an hour away, and that's where she saves her money. And it has an ATM system and all that. She sniffed up her ATM cards. And her logic was, I've got this big thing, this hard thing that's happening. I need to sock away money, and I've got to keep temptation at bay. So she
Her Odysseus tying herself to the mast is the distance between
exactly.
her and the
bank. Exactly. She's like, if I have a really, really need, I'll drive that hour. But yeah. Otherwise, gives the... And this is a big finding in general, that there's a tension when you're in this situation between needing that structure, right, tying yourself to the mast, but also recognizing there are going to be times when you really need the money. And that's super hard, to have both flexibility and structure in the same arrangement. We don't think about it most of the time, but when you start to see these patterns, you see that households are in a very difficult situation and are trying to juggle things which at some level are fundamentally incompatible.
You mentioned, sorry Rachel, one second, yeah. You mentioned football season. It's remarkable how much you can see football season in Mississippi on there,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, you can see tax season there in February.
Yeah, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
That, I just wanted to point that out. It's because you sort of don't think about the extent to which kind of the basic, the kind of patterns of life that affect us in terms of what we're reading the paper and seeing on TV, but don't affect our paychecks.
Yeah.
Was there another chart you wanted to show? I saw one flash before.
Yeah. So this is, as we thought about this, what we really see is an ongoing instability, and we really thought a lot about to what extent is that a problem? Like, why is that a problem? Because obviously, if you have a lot of volatility, but you have a high income, you just smooth it out over time, right? So I started my career in the private sector. Most of my earnings came at bonus season, but it was fine, right? Nobody should worry about me because I could just smooth it out myself, right? So people have different ways to then cope with the ups and downs in their lives, and we ultimately felt like the way to think about this is that volatility itself is a problem if it's combined with other things, right? So if your income is too low to be able to cushion it yourself through income, if your friends and family are similarly struggling and can't help, then volatility becomes a big problem. And the interconnectedness of communities financially was a big theme for us as we did this work. If you have great financial tools and advice, then you can figure out strategies like Janice's of using a bank that's far away. And so really, at the end of it, like we came to think of your ability to achieve a stable financial life as this two-by-two box, as that if you had the combination of volatility and a lack of ways to cope with that volatility, you were going to find yourself in trouble. And what's interesting is, as I think about the families that we got to know, very few of them are in the far right-hand corner of this two-by-two because, as Jonathan said, for the most part, people are figuring out ways to cope. But it is the case that most of them were sort of lurking around the sort of upper end of that quadrant, probably. And the tools and ways that they have to cope only work some of the time, partially, and with a bunch of pain, right? So Janice is having to kill an hour to drive to the credit union. And it's not always working for her. Like during the winter months, she spends less money on food. So, right, so people are feeling this struggle. Yeah. And we really thought of that as this third, like, hidden inequality, right? We're quite aware that income inequality has grown. We're quite aware, and increasingly so, that wealth inequality is a real problem. But really, there's this third piece, which is an unequal ability to achieve stability.
Before we talk about solutions from mm-hmm. both the private sector and government, let's spend a minute on what here is new and what's not new yeah. here, because I think that's really interesting. I think there is a sort of a broad perception that society has never been more volatile than it is now. But some of that perception is wrong, right? If you mm-hmm. kind of look at the numbers, we actually used to have more layoffs and more new business creation than we have had over the last 15 years. Mm-hmm. Our problem over the last 15 years is actually more not enough dynamism than it is too much dynamism, right? You used to have many more workers. When you think about the factory workers of yore, many of them weren't working 12 months a year, right? They were going on temporary layoff. Mm-hmm. So there are aspects of this sort of volatility that are not new, and then there are aspects that clearly are new. Can you sort of help us sort through what's new here and what has always existed? And to be clear, even if it's always existed, it still might be a big problem, right?
Right. Yeah, I mean, I think that the big thing that we're putting on the table that's new is this attention to cash flows, right? And so we've had conversations about changes in income, changes in wealth, as Rachel was saying, but this focus on the ups and downs within the year really is new. And the fact that so many workers are bearing the risk of the whole enterprise, the whole company, because they're seeing it in their paychecks. And they're not in a good position to handle that. What's not new is the ups and downs that go from year to year, the big things, the health problems, the job loss. We've been thinking about that for a while, at least since the 70s and 80s. We've seen it. But we just haven't really been able to get our minds around it. It's pretty much been an academic conversation and hasn't really connected to solutions. Like, well, how can we design better financial products, or how should that affect welfare policy? So the other part of it, which is, again, not new, but which I think really hasn't been appreciated, is just how, once you see ups and downs in people's lives, how it changes frameworks for thinking about poverty. We still have this idea that there are poor people, and there are people who are not poor. And basically, we can think about policy to help people who are poor and proceed that way. But in fact, when you look at the national data, when you look at our data, it's very clear that that picture really distorts what's happening, that households are moving in and out of poverty with some frequency. So Becky and Jeremy, the couple from Ohio, the long-haul truck mechanic, they're not poor, on average. If you look at their income, they're, I think, at $38,000, which puts them safely above poverty lines in that part of Ohio.
Yep.
But 6 months out of the year, 6 months out of the year, they actually dip below the poverty line. And Becky went out, she got food stamps, they got state health insurance. And so they were sometimes poor. They were poor, but not poor. Becky didn't really know how to think about it. And she felt terrible, actually. She's said there are people who are so much worse off than us. And yet, she found herself in this situation. But it's not just Becky and Jeremy. This happened a lot. We looked at households that were at around the median income in their areas. About a third of them had at least a month over the year when they dipped below the poverty line. And so this idea of the poor and the not poor just doesn't fit, and people are looking to welfare policy, they're trying to use whatever's out there to try to get some support, but it's not really designed well for it. And it's sort of one of the big things that as a nation, if we're trying to provide supports, we really need to rethink.
Yeah, and you know, we're not up here to explain the election. There are people far better positioned, far better able to do that than us.
But there may actually be no one who can explain the election.
That's possible. That's fair. But I do think this poor, not poor distinction is important, right? So you started out by saying we have these snapshots, right? And the snapshots are of our economy look pretty good. Unemployment, not a problem, right? We're growing. The snapshots look fine, but it's then when you actually see that chart for Janice's income or hear that Becky spent 6 months of the year under the poverty line that you, I think, start to understand why people feel very insecure. And even if the overall annual numbers around how their year played out are fine. They don't feel fine. They're still worried. Right, Becky's still worried about whether or not she can pay her mortgage. So I think that's, I don't know if that's new, but I know it's important.
Yeah. So let's now talk a little bit about solutions. Let's start with let's start with the public sector. What kinds of government policies, from either a federal or a state local perspective, do you think could, or the kinds of things that we should think about given the problem that you've just described?
Right. So there's a lot of things, and there's big things that'll be hard to achieve, and then there's smaller things that will also be hard to achieve.
Yep.
Right.
We should talk about both, though, right?
Yeah.
Because one of the things that Larry Summers says is that there are these ideas that seem as if they're never ever going to happen, but sometimes there's a moment and they happen, and you need to be you need to lay the groundwork intellectually, policy-wise, expertise-wise to make them happen.
Yeah, so. Absolutely. So, you know, there's a long list here, right? I would start with the tax code, right? We spend $400 billion on tax incentives of different types for long-term savings, for retirement, for mortgage interest deduction, for savings for education. Those are huge and important goals, all of them. But we don't spend really anything on helping people to save for the near term. And for the most part, that $400 billion goes to wealthier individuals. So it's just upside down. If we're going to try and help people achieve stability through the tax code, let's help the people who are most unstable.
And let's just, people throw out big numbers all the time.
Right.
Some big numbers aren't actually big. $400
right.
billion dollars is a really big number. It's between 2 and 3% of GDP.
Uh-huh.
It is, you know, it's, I think, more than 10% of the federal government. It is a massive expenditure of society's resources.
It really is. It really is. And so there's a lot of potential. And there are plenty of ideas. I'm sure, you know, some of the people in this room are the ones who've been advocating for them about how to do that, whether it's expanding the ITC or coming up with a new credit. I think there's a variety of ways that would work, but the fundamental issue that it's upside down is really the problem and the starting point.
Then there's a series of protections, right? I mean, one of the things, if you sort of think broadly, is that there's just too much risk on the wrong shoulders. And so, you know, households are really not in a great position to bear the risks of business up and downs and health crises and other kinds of volatility. They're bearing that. So one of the things in terms of protections are like some simple consumer protections, right? It's striking to us seeing the conversation now around the CFPB, right? It's not clear what's going to happen to the Consumer Finance Protection Bureau, but for these households, who a lot of them are Trump voters or in that group, they really benefit from what the CFPB has been trying to do to enhance transparency, to restrict some of the most predatory kinds of financial products. The CFPB has really been helping this part of America that's really struggling with volatility and not having great financial products. But ironically, you know, it's now under threat.
Can you connect for us the volatility and the Consumer Finance Protection Board? So what is the, how, what are the kinds of things they're doing that essentially mitigate volatility?
So it's really this that 2x2 box that Rachel was just talking about. It's not really that important to see it, but the big issue is, you know, if you're dealing with these ups and downs, you need to have good tools to cope, right? And you know, a lot of the households just don't have great tools. So for example, Janice, who works in the casino in Mississippi, she got in trouble and went to the payday lender. She hated it and took too long to get out of it. As a result, she took her box of checks and she snipped them up, and she never ordered any more. Mm. She did that because that was the only way she could get protection from this industry. CFPB is trying to do something more reasonable, which is to try to find some balance so that you can have short-term loans like that, but in a way that's more transparent, regulated.
Right.
Often it's state regulations, but CFPB is trying to do that, and they're trying to do it with credit cards and overdrafts, and just to create transparency so that folks feel more in control.
Right, and I would add on to that, that as we regulate financial services, we have to think about consumer protection. We also have to think about how to foster innovation.
Mm-hmm.
And the CFPB has really led there, and you see the OCC and other regulators focusing here also. But some of the most interesting ways to help people budget or plan or manage volatility are going to happen through technology. And they're going to happen through a range of different kinds of solutions. And that's hard for our regulatory structure to get its head around, right? Even if a regulated bank comes up with a new way of delivering insurance, or not insurance necessarily from a bank, but a new product, right? They're going to have to work with the regulators to make sure that it's a reasonable and safe product. And that can be very hard for the regulators, when it regulatory community, if it's something that's genuinely new, genuinely different. And so this balance of consumer protection and fostering innovation is really critical. And because the CFPB starts from a perspective of we're about the customer, or about how we help people, they've been a really needed voice in the regulatory, very complicated regulatory landscape.
How should we think about this idea of a universal basic income in this light? This is getting more attention. There's a bunch of really interesting work on it. I'll confess I'm skeptical of it, because I think that the dignity, the happiness, the life satisfaction, all kinds of things that come with work are the sorts of things we should be encouraging as a society rather than a universal basic income. On the other hand, if you talk about kind of this sheer amount of volatility, I could see that advocates for universal basic income would point to exactly this as evidence of why we need it, because it's foam on the runway of people's lives.
Yeah, I think that's, I similarly start out with some skepticism, but it's a very curious, interested, and hopeful skepticism. Like, I'd like to be proven wrong in a way, because, so I agree with you wholeheartedly. I think people value work and value, the feeling of satisfaction that comes from a paycheck. There is ways to think about the universal basic income where it's not framed as a handout. It's framed as something you deserve because you are a part owner in this society, and we're all sharing in the wealth that our society has created. And I think there's a long history of ideas around how to share the wealth. And so in that sense, the universal basic income to me is a sort of natural evolution and cousin to the child savings account work that's been done, or other thinking around how to make sure that everyone might have an initial grant to go to college, or right. And so I think there's a way to talk about and think about those kinds of transfers so that it feels like something that is right. So nobody thinks about Social Security as a handout, right? Because I contributed to our society and now I'm getting back. And yet when you think about the wealth creation that's coming, that is happening today, even though much of the wealth creation happens because of an overall societal investment we've made in infrastructure, for example, or in education, nonetheless, we don't all share equally in that wealth. So there's, I think, ways to think about it that are important.
Yeah, and I think to get back to on the UBI in particular, you know, we think about it as a transfer of money in that simple language, but in fact, what's powerful about it is that it's a regular check that's coming month after month. And in that sense, it's very much one of the few things which is very much directed at smoothing cash flows within the year. And that makes it different from lots of other policies. But again, I think all three of us probably, you know, have some skepticism about whether it's the optimal use of resources.
It also reminds me of all the good work that's been done on microfinance in developing countries. Obviously, we're talking about totally different levels there, right? Many of the folks that you're talking to, if you plotted a spectrum of the world, they'd be really high, right, in terms of world income, all kinds of things. But there are some real similarities there. And so that leads me into wonder, what kind of innovation could you imagine from the private sector really playing a role here? Are there products that you think there is latent demand for that could make a difference in people's lives?
Yeah. Having spent 20 years of my career, I think, writing on microfinance in developing countries, there's something interesting about microfinance, which I think people don't fully appreciate. So microfinance is sort of described as a small loan for usually poor women, often in South Asia, to invest in a business and grow the business, and it's a private sector solution to poverty. One of the really amazing things when you see how microfinance works on the ground is that it's not just a small loan, it's a small loan that's broken down into 52 installment repayments. And so while it doesn't get a lot of attention, Muhammad Yunus and his staff thought through the cash flow implications, the kind of thing that Rachel and I see and have made so central, thought through the cash flow implications and designed a product that would match with people's cash flow so they could pay it off a little bit week after week after week after week. So one of the things that we sort of see is that a lot of products out there are not designed with people's cash flows in mind, right? They require big payoffs or, you know, big contributions to saving.
Right?
Yeah.
Boom,
yeah.
Boom, boom.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so we started to see, especially with some of the new technologies, that you can design better products, not just to accommodate people's cash flows, but to help people manage those cash flows better.
Right. Yeah, so one interesting way to think about this is that in the developing context, in the microfinance context, what was really missing was pure and simple access, right? So this is a particularly well-designed product, but it's also the case that people just lacked access to financial services and still lack access to financial services. In the US, that's hard to say that. Most people, I mean, everybody we've talked about on stage today has bank accounts. So it's not a simple matter of including more people in financial services usage. It's a matter of, are the financial services that they're using enabling them to live their best financial life? So at CFSI, we talk about it as, are financial services increasing people's financial health or not? And that's what's really missing, is financial services that that can work well enough with your financial life that they make you better off because of how they are designed. So for example, one company we write about in the book is a company called Even. And
EVEN.
EVEN. And I think this is a precursor for what's to come, from whether it's from banks or from startups. Because we now can see so much more information about people's financial lives. So what Even does is, you know, you link your bank account to their app. They track your cash flows over time, right? So they would look at Janice's income. They would see those ups and downs. They would calculate the average. And then in months when she's low, she can get a boost, right? And in months when she's high, they send her a note saying, do you want to save? And like that use of data and analytics is where we're headed in order to create smart, useful advice for people in the real-time advice that's actionable and is connected to, and it's personalized, right? So we're not there yet, but that's where we're headed given the amount of data that is increasingly exists.
And there's so much good research on this now that we didn't have 10 or 20 years ago. I mean, the behavioral finance stuff by people like Richard Thaler and others, and there are ideas there where you try to get, where you say to people, hey, you just got a raise. Do you want to park a little of it in retirement savings?
Yeah.
Which people are kind of willing to do because they're feeling flush and it feels kind of off in the future.
Right.
And you can imagine versions of that that are targeted less at professionals who we need to get to save more, and more people who are trying to get by week to week, month to month. Mm-hmm. The thing that I want to end on is, we've talked about policy, we've talked about product, but so many of the folks here and people in policy generally work in areas that touch all kind of realms, whether it's healthcare, whether it's education. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me there are really important lessons here for nearly any segment of society that touches people's money, which is nearly every segment of society.
Right.
Elliot Gerson and I have this shared obsession of the fact that there are huge numbers of really talented low-income kids who nonetheless don't graduate from college, which is really a terrible, it's a shameful failing on our part of society of these kids who's overcome something. And there are a bunch of colleges that have started to do things that do a better job of not only enrolling these kids, but making sure that they stay on and graduate. And one of the things they've learned reminds me of your research, which is for deans who deal directly with students, it's really important to have, sometimes literally, sometimes figuratively, cash sitting in a drawer. So a kid comes into your office and says, I'm sorry, I can't take my test on Friday. You hope they come into the office because my mom just had this happen. Imagine it's Janice's kid, right? And the way to keep that kid in school sometimes is to get that kid $100 this week. And it just seems to me, and I'd ask you to kind of end on a version of this, what you want people to think about, whether you work in healthcare at a hospital, whether you're at a foundation that touches healthcare, education. There's so many different realms where this work should sort of inform the way we think about how we deal with people in so many different realms.
Yeah, I'm so glad that you're ending there. I'm not sure I can say it better than you just did, to be honest. I think But I'll offer a story, like a last story, and I'm sure Jonathan will add on, that I think is relevant. So one of the families we got to know is a couple called that we called Sarah and Sam Johnson. And during the year that we were tracking data, Sarah was working, going to college, and starting a community performing arts program for little kids, because she had a small kid. Plus, at the same time, she had a grown child who was about to graduate from college, I mean, from high school. So like a really complicated life, but a busy, full, like exactly what you want anybody's life to look like in a lot of ways, right? Integrated into our community, deeply invested in her family, moving forward. But when we caught up with her a few years later, as we were writing, she had so much good news to report, right? She had been elected to the city, to the local school board, as a result of the work she'd done in her community. Her son was doing great in college. She had just graduated from college and was now starting a master's program. And so all of this excitement, right? But at the same time, she had just had to declare bankruptcy. And it's this juxtaposition between like the financial, like the way her financial life was working and all of these other goals. And all of these other goals she was working towards were really in jeopardy. It's the college story. In her case, the bankruptcy was caused by medical issues, right? She had no choice but to take her son to the emergency room at some point. It was absolutely the right thing to do for administrative reasons. His insurance had lapsed. She thought he had insurance. And so the interplay between people's health, their ability to work, their ability to meet their financial objectives, their ability to meet their educational objectives is so strong. And I think we are all, like all of us who work on social change, going to be so much more effective if we embrace that interconnectedness. If in our youth opportunity programs we think about financial well-being, if in our financial well-being programs we think about educational goals, the same could be said about housing or healthcare or anything, really.
Yeah. Thank you both.
Thank you.
We are out of time.
It's been great.
Thank you.